we at GAGE and analysis of the documents placed before it to make the factual finding that the petitioners before him had made out a prima facie case which obligated the appellant to answer by evidence. That evidence was not forthcoming beyond the three paragraphs in the prima affidavit as the appellant elected to give the trial and the witness box a wide berth. What was the learned judge to do in the face of that curious decision on the part of the appellant? First, we agree that under the election petition rules, it was obligatory for the appellant as a party to appear and participate in the proceedings. He ought to have made himself available, at the very least, for cross-examination on his declaring affidavit. That much is clear from Rule 12.13, which provides that every proponent of an affidavit shall subject to the election court's discretion to examine the chief and cross-examine. That is so unless the parties by consent agree to admit affidavit evidence as presented without cross-examination of the deponent. There was no consent for the appellant's excusal and no explanation whatsoever was given for his failure to testify. As to the consequences of such deliberate and restrained absenteeism on the part of the appellant, we find persuasive the judgment of Lightman J of the English High Court of Justice in Raja versus Van Hoogstraten. After finding that the defendant had given no reason for not attending the trial and that there was no credible justification other than a well-founded concern that this account would not survive oral examination, the judge inferred that he had run scared of cross-examination and in the circumstances, good advance inference may be drawn from his failure to give evidence on the issue on which he might reasonably be expected to answer the case against him. To state his witness statement in issue in the case which ought reasonably to be tested may carry little or no weight and three. Then charge evidence against him may without more be accepted so long as it is credible. That reasoning is in consonance with the Privy Council decision in Gibbs v. Rare, 1988, to the effect that when defendants elect to give no evidence, such a choice carries the risk that did transpire that there was some evidence tending to establish the plaintiff's case, albeit slender evidence, their silence in circumstances in which they would be expected to answer might convert that evidence into proof. Now, without a doubt, there had been placed before the learned judge sufficient evidence on which he would, without more, find for the petitioner as against the appellant. The issue of the appellant's academic qualifications was a matter specifically within the appellant's knowledge. He and he alone could have testified as to which high school, if any, he attended and what grades he attained. He alone could speak as to when he was enrolled at which university to study which course and for what duration. Only he could say what his student number was, who his tutors and lecturers were, what grades he attained and when he graduated. Only he could explain the straight absence of his name from the graduation list for the day the degree certificate he produced related to. Only he could explain why, being a graduate, if one he was, as from 1st March 2012, he would have stated under oath to a committee of parliament more than 2 years later on September 2014, that he had enrolled at Kampala University but was yet to graduate. Finally, he alone could explain how, not having graduated as at September 2014, he somehow managed to have in his possession and present to the IEBC a master's degree issued in March 2015 but which is somehow forgot that he had when he filled the self-declaration form in 2017, stating that his highest academic qualification was a bachelor's degree. Those are the facts he was reasonably expectant to depose to in his affidavit. Those are the questions he was expectant to answer in cross-examination, yet he chose not to. We have set out these rather open and uncontested issues, not because we are delving into an examination of factual issues, which we cannot, being jurisdictionally debarred, but only to show that the learned judge, and affirm and secure indeed a compelling basis for making the categorical factual conclusion at paragraph 198 of his judgment that, quote, in my view, the first respondent failed to show that he had actually obtained the two degrees from Kampala University. The petitioners proved his case to the required standard. The source and how the two degrees came into being are facts that were in the special knowledge of the first respondent. In view of the uncontroverted evidence on record, they are not what they purport to be. End of quote. We think that given the facts that we have established before him, the running judge properly distinguished the case of Janet Dogo, the Kimbo Mete versus IBC, on the basis that in the latter case, the respondent had undertaken the studies leading to the conferment of the subject degree and was only waiting to graduate so that he was academically qualified well in the case, and there was no evidence that the appellant did undertake the academic studies at the university. There really can be no difficulty, therefore, in arriving at the conclusion that the running judge was justified on the evidence and the law to hold and find that the appellant was not legally cleared to vie for the position of governor, as he did not satisfy the qualification criteria set out in section 22.2 of the Elections Act. He was not eligible to contest, and the jury, to that finding and conclusion, fails as it is bound to. The consequence of that finding is obvious: the election of the appellant and to be invalidated. A person who is not qualified to vie for a particular seat cannot hold on to his first victory by pointing to the margin of his vote vis-a-vis his competitors. He ought not to have been in the race in the first place, and the alleged victory is a distortion of reality and a subversion of the electoral process. In this respect, we agree with the persuasive decision of the Supreme Court of India in Mailembam Prithviraj Singh versus Pukrem and Asar Hussain versus Rajiv Gabi. The effect of our holding of the learned judge on the question of the appellant's lack of academic qualification is that it renders our examination of the other grounds of appeal quite superfluous. The reason is quite simple. Whether the election was properly conducted or not, or was fraught with irregularities or so grave a character that they affected not only the credibility of the election but the results of the election as well, so that no reasonable tribunal can uphold them, as the running judge found, must stand invalidated because the person declared the winner, namely the apparent, was not qualified to vie and was not validly elected. That being the inescapable adjudicative result, we do not see any utility in embarking on a forensic examination of the other grounds in pursuit of a merely deductive of academic aim. In the result, the appeal before us is devoid of merit and is dismissed with cause to the first and second respondents. The cross appeal by IEBC and the returning of Samas also perforce is that dismissed, but with no orders as to costs. Orders accordingly.